Drama to Inish, we decided that for junior play we wanted something that was a little bit challenging for that age range. It had been done maybe 15 or 16 years ago in the school as a senior play. I remember seeing it, very vague memories of liking it. And with this fairly good young troupe that's coming through at the moment in the younger forms, we felt it might be worth a pop. But it's an Irish play by an Irish playwright, something that we hadn't done for a while.
No!
Wait!
Ross!
Neither one of you, I don't know.
The play begins with the sister of the hotel proprietor fussing about new arrivals. And in fact, it's the lowly serving girl, Helena, who's able to sort her out on the different room numbers. It seems that some, well, thespians are on their way. And this is the whole crux of the play.
Helena! Helena!
You called, ma'am? Miss, I mean.
I should think you did call. Where's all have you been?
I was at the Hins, miss.
Why couldn't Michael have done that?
Sure, Michael's gone to meet the train.
Can't be that late. Oh, me gracious, it's gone 11:30. The train will be in any minute.
It's in already, miss. I heard a puff and an eye in the backyard.
Well now, Helena, we must keep clear, cool heads. There's quite a crowd of people arriving on that train, but there's no need for us to get into a fuss. Quite the contrary. It'd be a queer thing if we weren't able to deal in a quiet, business-like way with half a dozen or ten guests.
Yes, miss, to be sure.
If you'd only come the first time I'd called you.
It's with the Hins, miss.
I know. Where's Master Eddie?
Gone to the train, miss.
Why so?
I don't know, miss. He put on his new suit after breakfast. I heard him telling his poppy he was gone to meet the train.
Oh, to be sure. Miss Lambert's amongst the arrivals. Which brings us back to business, Helena. She'd better have number 12. No, I'm keeping that room for Mr. Delamere and Miss Constantia.
Mr. and Miss Constantia. Glory, miss.
It's quite all right, Helena. Actresses they are. I mean, she's an actress and so is he. No, I mean, he's an actor and so is... Oh, well, anyhow, they're man and wife these years and years. O'Hara, or some name like that, I believe they are, really.
You see, miss?
Where were we at all? Miss Lambert, number 12, and...
Let you leave it to me, miss. I'll straighten it out. Miss Lambert, number 10. Mr. Hunt, number 12. Mr. Cronin, 14. And the play actors are in 15.
I believe there are one or two others coming, but sure, I've lost the bit of paper.
Yeah, it's been directed by myself and Evan Jameson, who's got a great eye for the acting detail, and in fact I've been more coordinating stuff in the background. He's had more and more time close in with the actors and in straightening out certain details. So he's been brilliant all the way through, a really good person to bounce ideas off.
This is not scripted.
I'll call you back in a second.
Oh no!
Hello. That's really
young. A houseboy bit, yeah. Oh no! I'm not a houseboy.
My favourite part in the play is where I get to give out to Nevin for his drinking habits. And I really enjoy that because it's just something different. And I'm not normally a character where I'm angry. So it was nice having kind of a difference with that.
Tosha Granver Orinta Och Tosha Anna Dorira Freshen August Ismala Mishid Mar Toshan Defriel.
And the only way I could, I'm no speechifier, was by my vote.
So you voted against the government?
Against the government?
Against the government!
I did.
Jane Image Alon Ruddy Defriel and Shot, like Emery in Sport. Emery there, Lon Ruddy August Captain Gulshan, Va Ashdorak to Freshen.
And I kind of find sometimes I'm speaking in the accent out of here, out of play.
The cast have been really good and they've been really good to work with in their good natured way of going on. But the one problem was it's afflicted the whole college during our rehearsal period has been illness and sickness. And we're not making excuses.
It was quite difficult because we had to do a lot of like blocking without people and a lot of people got confused, but I think we've worked over it.
But essentially, there has hardly been a rehearsal where we've had everyone there.
Yeah, I think it was really good. Mr. Swift and Mr. Jameson were very nice about it, like about everyone being sick, and worked through it well as well.
Mr. Swift could have an opinion on the way someone should look, and Mr. James will have a completely different opinion, and it's nice because it kind of gives you a chance to see both perspectives.
But in the end, it worked out really well. We got really good points from both. We learned how to make the audience more interested in what we were doing, which was good.
Maintain focus tonight and concentrate really hard. Last night was better than the night before, there's no question. But what do we have to do tonight?
Energy.
Absolutely, energy levels. And that starts with people walking on stage, saying their line loudly. Grace, I want to hear that. I don't care if it hurts you. I want to hear you speaking really loudly when you come on. Right? Okay. Yes! Oh, these two come in and you're absolutely bewildered, starstruck, amazed. And react without speaking. You have a duty to come in loud, with lots of energy. If you don't, you'll pull the play down. You come on and the energy comes up again. Because you're loud, right? Whatever, Catherine, you know. Hello, whichever, you know. You're bringing it up again, right? So it's really important that you stride onto that stage with confidence and loudness.
And sure enough, when Walter Delamere and his wife Constance Constantia arrive into the living room of the Seaview Hotel, they do make a splash. In fact, some of their slightly pretentious pronouncements on the arts of drama have the locals somewhat bamboozled.
Now, Miss Constantia and Mr. Delamere, here's to your very successful season.
And here is to you, sir, and to Inish. May our visit be profitable to the town. Spiritually, I mean.
So why did you go in for them so? If it's not a rude question.
Because, Mr. Tuig, they may revolutionise some poor person's soul.
Asher, we've had enough of revolutions.
I mean that some young man in the audience may see himself there on the stage, in all his lust, in all his selfishness. A young man, such as your son.
It's a poor Eddie. There never was a more innocent boy.
I meant nothing personal. Or some middle-aged man may see himself there on the stage, the sham cloak of virtue torn from his shoulders, and he shall stand exposed as the rotten sham he is. Women will see themselves vain, empty-headed, scheming for power, scheming for husbands, scheming for lovers.
Heaven defend us.
'Tis like a mission.
It is a mission, Miss Dewey, a tremendous mission, where the pulpit is the stage and the great dramatists preach the sermons.
So as the play progresses into the second and third acts, contrary to what everybody seems to believe, these plays by Ibsen and Chekhov, Strindberg, these psychologically harrowing European dramas, are actually a sellout with the locals. There's reports of people jumping off piers, arson, and even the poisoning of relatives in the hope of gaining their will.
Good morning, Miss Lattery.
Good morning, Miss Tuhig.
Me brother is out, but can I do thing for you?
Just the one that can. Do you see that? Tis a grand dwee killer you sold to McTobin a few months back. I want the one like of it. And they told me down the shop, it's you that had the key to all the poisons.
So I have. Keel, quick. Ah, Miss Lattery, isn't it a pity we're not allowed to stop that any longer? 'Twas too poisonous altogether.
Is that so? Well, have you any rat poison?
Lashings of it.
Can I buy some?
Of course you can.
Now, just a minute, Miss Lattery. Pardon my butting in, but what exactly do you want the weed killer for?
For my weeds.
Of course. And failing the weed killer, you want rat poison?
For my rats.
Of course. I see. I imagine, Miss Lattery, that you are very unhappily married.
Sure, the poor girl's not married at all.
Oh.
She lives with an old termagant of an aunt, who's rotten with money, and won't give her more than a sixpence a week in her pocket. Pardon me saying so, Miss Lattery.
It's no more than the truth.
But you will come into all of her money when she dies.
I suppose I will.
Very interesting.
I'll have my keys in a minute.
Maybe I won't mind today. I'll get a few panic the sweets instead.
And no trouble at all.
I think I'll keep this.
You will not!
Good morning, Miss Tuhig. Is your brother about?
He's not.
Or the mistress?
She's out too. Why do you want them? What can I do for you?
Well, I wanted to prepare them like...
Prepare them?
Break the news, as you might say.
Merciful heavens, what's happened?
It's Master Eddie.
Eddie? Eddie, he's dead?
No, miss, but he's terrible wet.
Wet?
Yes, miss. He was in the sea.
Bathing?
No, miss. In his clothes.
Is he after falling in? Oh, poor little Eddie.
No one knows rightly how he got into the sea, miss.
And who rescued him?
He rescued himself, miss. It seems he got out of the White Rocks. Maybe he fell in, or maybe he... No matter. Anyway, he walked out to himself and hid among the rocks, because he was ashamed, like, to walk through the town, dripping wet. But a lad came on him and brought him back, and he's having a sup of whiskey at Breen's, so I thought I'd come ahead and give you all the bend.
With this junior play then, that's the second major production, I suppose, along with the senior play for the academic year, and we hope to keep improving and keep challenging these young actors who seem to be going from strength to strength.